professor of demography at the University of Florence in Italy, and he's also a PI of the ERC grant Economic Uncertainty and Fertility in Europe. And he has been holding also numerous other research grants. He's also an editor of the demographic journal Genus. His research is widely linked to family demography and its relations with socioeconomic status of individuals and subjective well-being. And his main research interest is actually economic uncertainty. And he really contributed to this strand of research in family demography by trying to describe economic uncertainty and also measure it. And I think we will all make use, at least in our research, make use of his research in this field. And also, I would like to say that recently for his research so far, which he conducted so far, and in particular for his contributions to this strand of economic uncertainty and fertility, he obtained a scientific award from the European Association for Population Studies, the Dirk van de Kaa Award. So this is just a few words about Daniele. And Daniele, the floor is yours. We are happy to have you here and listen to your presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Anna, very much for the introduction, and thank you very much for the invitation. It's true, yes, we are collaborating since long time. We are a sort of de facto couple in research, let's say like that. And I'm really happy to be here with you and to see that you are establishing this very interesting center in Warsaw. I'm also very happy to be here with all of you and have the possibility to share some ideas about the fertility decision-making process under conditions of uncertainty. So in the presentation, I will take the, more or less the first half of the presentation to present the framework, the theoretical framework we are using to study how individuals may take decisions under uncertain conditions. And then on top of all the uncertainties that our world is facing today, the COVID-19 pandemic entered our lives. So, and of course, the COVID-induced uncertainty may have strong consequences on decision-making about family events. So the second part, in the second part of the presentation, I will take this opportunity to present you some work in progress. So I will be very happy to receive comments, feedbacks. I will show you some results about the effect of the COVID-19 lockdown, of the Italian lockdown on fertility intentions. And the starting point of the presentation is this graph. You may have seen it already, and because currently Europe is facing a new fertility winter. Norway reached its lowest total fertility in history in 2019. Finland also reached its lowest total fertility in history in 2019, down from 1.9 in 2010. And the total fertility in Finland is now 1.35. So basically, Finland is approaching the lowest low fertility regime. A bit further west, Scotland is also facing declining fertility rates since 2010. And even France is experiencing an unexpected fertility decline. Then you see here the black line. The black line is Italy. Of course, our fertility was already much lower than the other countries. But still, compared to our peak of fertility in 2010 of 1.46, fertility is again, now the recent estimates, about 1.28. So we are again totally within the lowest low fertility regime. And these are just a few examples of contemporary fertility trends in Europe. The question is why? What is happening? And the central explanation I will put forward in this presentation is the rise of uncertainty. the increasing speed, dynamics, and volatility of outcomes of globalization, and you are very interested to this part in the group there, the new wave of technological change make it increasingly difficult for individuals to predict their future and choose between alternatives and strategies. And the Great Recession that we all experienced has renewed the view that globalization is unpredictable and out of control. This state of affairs, we argue, generates an extraordinary level of uncertainty, which represents the game changer in contemporary societies and family life courses. What has been done so far? At the micro level, there is a lot of research on the topic. The empirical demographic tradition operationalizes the forces of uncertainty, especially through objective indicators of actual and past labor market situation, and at best by their subjective perceptions. Actually, papers addressing the relation between employment uncertainty and fertility are booming. Employment uncertainty has been often operationalized through the objective side of uncertainty, through unemployment, and more recently through temporary jobs. So this is a strand of research that is very now common in Europe. A new generation of studies are also underlining the importance of considering the persistence in employment uncertainty, not only the status of uncertainty, in the sense that employment uncertainty has been proved to be especially detrimental for fertility when the experience of unemployment or the experience of unstable employment career accumulates over young adults' life courses. And then this is the most detrimental force towards fertility. And finally, a few studies also recognize that uncertainty is not only about employment. Housing uncertainty might be equally important as employment uncertainties at the time of family formation. So this is a sort of state of the art of a lot of research that has been conducted so far for Europe. I actually love this type of research. I will certainly continue to do this type of research, and I'm working with several collaborators and postdocs on carrying out micro-level longitudinal analysis about the employment characteristics and fertility. But these analyses, although certainly informative, however, leave important questions unanswered, posing serious challenges to our understanding of the determinants of fertility. Let's take Northern Europe as an example. For instance, in 2009, Northern European economies resumed their economic growth, but their total fertility rate started to decrease substantially. So the question is, what are the driving forces of fertility decline in Nordic countries after a great recession that actually in hard numbers they really never experienced, or at least not to any relevant extent? And more generally, what are the drivers of the new fertility winter that contemporary European societies are currently facing? And actually, especially from a Southern European perspective, I also have to emphasize that the recent fertility decline challenges our demographic, many of our demographic theories, much of our classical thinking about fertility trends, because the European post-crisis shift toward very low fertility rates as highly unexpected, especially for in Nordic countries, not only because for us they represent not only because they have been much less severely hit by the crisis, but also because they represent a benchmark in terms of gender equality, female labor force participation, youth emancipation, and diffusion of new family forms, all factors that are known to be associated with higher fertility, or at least we were used to it. So the question is, what is happening? And I believe that while the Great Recession is over, uncertainty remains and continues to affect our private lives. But the point is, do we understand economic uncertainty? Actually, the definition of uncertainty is rather clear. Uncertainty means the lack of clarity about future economic prospects, which in economic terms means unknown probability distributions to possible outcomes. So already from this very first definition of uncertainty is clear that uncertainty is about the future, not about the present or the past. And that cumulative employment disadvantage and its perception just identify what we can refer to as the statistical shadow of the past and tell us little about uncertain futures. Consequently, what I would like to argue is that to properly address the effects of fundamental uncertainty on family dynamics, we need to change slightly perspective, recognize that uncertainty is a forward-looking notion. So our point is that uncertainty needs to be conceptualized and operationalized, taking into account that people use works of imagination, producing their own narrative of the future. So uncertainty is strongly anchored in narratives that are imagined future embedded in social elements. These narratives of the future become potent driving forces of reproductive decisions in spite of uncertainty, irrespective of structural constraints and their subjective perception. So that is the core idea, but let me try to be in this presentation more analytical and present our theoretical approach, our narrative framework. Also because I saw here Irena Kotowska connected, so I don't want to do the same presentation she already heard, so I decided to change, and I'm presenting you in a much more analytical way our narrative framework. So there are, of course, different elements involved in the fertility decision-making process. And the first element is this first circle, which is, of course, all the past experience, past education, employment, partnership, or mobility experiences, just to cite some examples, are clearly crucial in the decision-making process. And a lot of a new strand of demographic literature also emphasizes that these experiences are shaped by personal predispositions, by personality traits, like risk aversion or time discounting preferences that may influence fertility choices. Then the second level to be considered is the present status, which is the contingent economic and employment situation. And after all, the cumulative past experiences over the life course and the present status are the standard elements we are usually employing as determinants of fertility intentions and behaviors. Then the additional element of the framework is perceptions. The next level concerns perceptions of the personal condition and of the context. Here, Michaela Kreienfeld, in her influential paper in 2010 in European Sociological Review, pioneered a new strand of literature in which the actual economic conditions are coupled with their perception. She recognized in her article that people with the same employment condition might, however, differ in the way they feel, tolerate and react to uncertainty, for example, because of several unmeasured job-related amenities. These three elements together synthesize basically the state of the art of the great majority of demographic studies. We can consider the sum of these elements as the shadow of the past elements of this narrative framework. These are the shadow of the past that influence the fertility decision-making process. But fertility decisions are not merely a shadow of the past. The specter of the future also matters. So we are adding here some further element compared to this classical setting. And the first additional element I would like to add is expectations. Expectations represent what people expect will happen in the future based on available information. What do you expect based on the type of situation you are facing in that moment? Expectations are then shaped by dreams, desire, or aspiration, what we can call as imaginaries. Imaginaries represent the human capacity to place oneself in an imagined situation, irrespective of the present condition. So imaginaries are, in our framework, of course, the major source of agency within the course of action. People can imagine a wishful future and try to reach this imagined future. All these elements find their proper synthesis in the narrative of the future. At this level, when people plan childbearing, all the previous elements find a synthesis in a narrative that is something actionable, something that you can reach. So the idea is that given your own personal predispositions, your past experience, your present condition, the status of the present condition, and the perception of the present condition, given the expected future and one's family imaginaries, the narrative of the future reflects the action that will allow an individual to reach the desired family imaginary. So this sum of expectations, imaginaries, and narrative of the future is the shadow of the future part of our framework. So this shadow of the future is what is, in our view, often disregarded in the study of fertility decision-making process, and especially in a moment of uncertainty in which the future and the knowledge about the future is uncertain, especially in that case, it is unknown what will happen, then this shadow of the future elements of the framework may become especially relevant. As you can see from this stylized representation, we do not consider these different elements as a causal sequence. Each element stems from the previous, but it exceeds the previous one. So in other terms, each new level is influenced but not determined by the previous level. Clearly, all these elements are also influenced by the social context, and especially in our era, they are strongly shaped by the media and the social media. Just to give you an example, three simple words, whatever it takes, pronounced by the then president of the European Central Bank, Mario Draghi, proved strong enough to debunk a global financial speculation against the euro in 2012. Of course, the European Central Bank was apparently ready to unleash its monetary power, but this proved to be unnecessary. Just the narrative of a new attitude of the European Central Bank was enough. And this is actually a textbook example which is used in economic sociology to suggest that social actors take decisions not only on the basis of structural constraints, but also of the narrative of the future. And clearly, narratives of the future are anchored in existing cultural and institutional frames, as well as public images produced by social media and the press. So as a corollary, a potent building block of personal narratives are shared narratives by the media. And this slide just illustrates a sample of articles that appeared in 2009. For instance, "Are we ready for the financial crisis of 2009? So always creating uncertainty about what will happen in the future. And in addition, uncertainty is not only economic uncertainty, the global political uncertainty also reinforces the fear of the future. You may have seen that in one of the most recent Eurobarometer, the threat of political instability seems to be among the biggest concern among European citizens. For instance, the long delay of the Brexit process had cast a shadow on the future prospects for everyone, both in the UK and also in the rest of Europe. This article from The Guardian, I think, is very representative. This also is an example about how the narrative of fertility changed in the media, seeping into private lives, my Brexit nightmare, readers on how the uncertainty is affecting their lives. So the global political uncertainty has reinforced the narrative of an uncertain future among European citizens. So we can add a last element of our narrative framework, the role of shared narratives that is supposed to be a decisive lens in our understanding of the shadow of the future. So this is basically our framework and the idea that we do need in the fertility decision making, not only to focus on actual constraints, but also on future expectations, imaginaries, the narrative of the future. And all this is strongly affected by the media, the narrative of the media and social media. So to summarize, the thesis I would like to put forward today is that in the era of uncertainty, the focus on past and actual structural constraints and their subjective perception is not enough to explain the new fertility winter in Europe. Net of factors that operationalize the statistical shadow of the past, and I'm using on purpose the word net of factors, because all these contingent economic and employment situation always needs to be controlled for in our statistical models. But net of these factors, young adults might postpone fertility because their narrative of the future is uncertain. This is in theory very nice, but we also want to test the role of narratives and to see whether there are relations between narratives and fertility. And in Florence, with a group in Florence, we are addressing the relationship between narratives and fertility from very many angles. First of all, what we are doing is running a cross-country laboratory and online experiments to assess the role of different economic narratives of the future on fertility intentions. In Italy, Norway, Germany, Poland, and the UK. I have no time, and this is not the object of this presentation. I have no time to show you the results of these experiments, but in case, feel free to email me. We do have some first papers out of it, and preliminary results are really showing a very strong causal effect of narratives of the future on fertility intentions, with all the limits that an experimental approach have. Of course, our results have strong internal validity and more limited external validity. So what we are doing also with a postdoc in Florence with competence in computer science is to use a combination of natural language processing methods to build an indicator of the level of economic uncertainty channeled by the online press and social media. We do have data about all published articles in Europe in the last 20 years, and we are using these 2 billion records to try to construct an indicator of the level of uncertainty channeled by the press and the social media. So the idea is to use this indicator to see how the narrative of uncertainty has changed over time and changes between different countries and different contexts. And then we will, of course, use this indicator as an aggregate level factor in our micro level analysis of fertility, net of traditional old-fashioned determinants of fertility, like unemployment, share of temporary employment. So we want to see whether the media narrative of uncertainty do affect individual decisions to have children. Regarding observational studies, unfortunately here, survey collecting both forward-looking measures of economic uncertainty and fertility are very few. I would be very much eager to know whether you have a clue about surveys that include fertility intentions or fertility outcomes coupled with expectations regarding the employment and the economic sphere. There are very few examples, but we do have a paper on the Italian OECD Trust Club survey. Here there are some expectations about future economic situation and employment situation, and these variables proved very, very crucial in predicting fertility intentions. And then we are also working on the Australian panel, the ILDA panel. There are a set of questions about what we'll expect to happen in the future with regard to the employment sphere. For instance, there is the notion of resilience, the ability to recover in case of adverse events. And we are using this data both on union to predict union formation and fertility, and they seem to have very, very powerful effects, not only significant, but also with a substantial magnitude on fertility and family formation. Finally, qualitative research could also add, of course, to a better understanding of the underlying mechanisms linking narrative of economic uncertainty and family life. Here, what we are doing is that we, in our lab, in our experiments, there is a control group. There is a control group that is not exposed to any manipulation of economic uncertainty. So to this control group, we asked several, very many open questions about the notion of uncertainty in their lives, their fear of the future, and we will be using this material to, we will combine this material to our quantitative analysis to gain a deeper understanding into the role of uncertainty in individuals' lives. Okay, so I will be more than happy to share with you the results concerning this fourth strand of research. In case, feel free to email me. Not all papers are ready, and we are not at the same level in all these four strands of research. However, I would like to use the opportunity of this talk today to share with you the most recent research we are carrying out now in Florence, because I was saying at the very beginning of the presentation, on top of all we have discussed so far about uncertainty, COVID-19 entered our lives. So we decided to study the effect and the uncertainty induced by COVID on family and fertility. And the results I'm presenting now are based on a joint work with Raffaele Guetto and Giacomo Bazzani from the University of Florence. So the COVID-19 disaster has created an enormous uncertainty shock, larger actually than the one associated with the financial crisis of 2008 and 2009, and more similar in magnitude to the rise of uncertainty during the Great Depression of 1929-1933. A recent paper reports that over 90% of newspaper articles in March 2020 mentioned COVID, coronavirus, pandemic, or other terms related to infectious diseases. And in another paper by the same authors, by considering three real-time, forward-looking uncertainty indicators, they used stock market volatility, newspaper-based economic uncertainty, and subjective uncertainty in business expectation surveys. They have estimated that more than half of the actual economic contraction in the United States is due to COVID-19-induced uncertainty. And actually, within the context of COVID-19, Italy offers, unfortunately, a unique case study. Italy is the first severe case of COVID-19 pandemic in the Western world. Italian faced the longest complete lockdown experience, 2 months in total. And at the end of April 2020, Italy had about 25,000 deaths due to COVID-19. And the media played a very strong role. It seems a bit caricatural, but it is true. At 6 p.m., Italians gathered in front of the TV for the official updates of the pandemic. and the TV announcement of the President Conte had more than 70% of share on TV, the double of Italy playing the FIFA World Cup, actually. So, from our point of view, the COVID-19 pandemic represents a unique occasion to test our narrative framework. Because of COVID-19 uncertainty, subjective states and personal narratives of the future, also influenced by media shared narratives, may gain the upper hand over the shadow of the past. So we have adapted our narrative framework to the experience of the coronavirus pandemic and collected information concerning all relevant dimensions of the framework. I have no time to enter into the theoretical adaptation of the narrative framework to study COVID. We have it in a paper, and I will eventually we can discuss about it. But I would like to present you the data we collected and on which we based this empirical investigation. We had we have conducted an online survey at the premises of the international survey company Lucid during the lockdown. This international company has a high academic reputation for its quality of data collection and rigor of data collection. This survey combines a longitudinal study, so we expect a follow-up in the next month. We wanted to do a follow-up because we did this this survey in the middle of the lockdown. We wanted to have a follow-up now, but we are again in a second wave of the pandemic, so we are postponing an eventual follow-up of this survey. And the longitudinal design is also coupled with an experimental approach. The total sample is 4,000 individuals. The data were collected between April 25 and May 1st, and we used quota sampling on men and women aged 20 to 40, setting a quota for gender, age, and region in the center and south of Italy and province in the north, because you may remember that in the first wave of the pandemic, Italy was differently affected by the pandemic, much more severely on the north. So we wanted a more specific geographic precision for the north. We collected several variables to operationalize the shadow of the past. So the past experience and personality traits, the status and objective exposition to coronavirus, so direct and indirect contact with coronavirus, media exposure, TV and web, and labor market situation, employment, social class, and transitions to not employment or any smart work following the pandemic. And also perceptions, the sense of insecurity regarding one's own health, labor market situation, the diffusion of the pandemic, and the general political and economic situations. In addition to this, we also collected some variables that may help to operationalize the shadow of the future, the shadow of the future dimensions. So expectation, how long do you think will it take before your personal situation comes back to its pre-pandemic condition? And how long do you think will it take before the economic and social situation in Italy comes back to its pre-pandemic condition? And also imaginaries. It's very difficult to catch imaginaries in a survey. In a recent paper we published, we give some recommendation in terms of data collection regarding imaginaries. And I'm fully aware that I'm already anticipating this. This is the weakest point of this analysis, in the sense that this variable may also be endogenous, of course, with our outcome in terms of fertility intentions. But we wanted to collect something about imaginaries. So we are here relying on the happiness literature and the literature on affective forecasting, asking how much having another child would make you happy. So what we ask, and there were no other way of doing it. So we ask, in January, before the coronavirus pandemic, were you planning to have a child in the following 3 years? And today, do you plan to have a child in the next 3 years? So what I'm showing you are just now some preliminary results of the change in fertility intentions because of the lockdown. So also, look, when I'm showing you now some covariates and some effects, always remember that we are not looking at determinants of fertility intentions. We look at determinants about change in fertility intentions before and after the pandemic. So it is different the way we look at the effects of the results. I'm not saying that some of the covariates are not affecting fertility intentions, are determinants of the change in fertility intentions. So I am including then imaginaries, expectations, perception, the present status, past conditions, and of course, we control for the level of fertility intentions in January. And also, in addition to this OLS regression, we also estimated a multinomial logistic regression to analyze the probability of fertility intentions decreasing, increasing, or remaining the same as before the pandemic. We also replicated all the analysis through an ordered logit model, and the results are pretty much consistent. So what are these? These are the determinants of the change in fertility intention after the pandemics based on the perceptions, expectations, and imaginaries. Our results suggest that perceptions, expectations, and imaginaries do play an important role in the change of fertility intentions after the pandemic, net of all the variables that summarize the statistical shadow of the past. Those who reduce their fertility intentions are those who feel insecure about their health, work, and economic conditions. And those who are more pessimistic expectations about the return to normality. Remember, we did this in the first wave, in which 3 months or 6 months seemed even realistic. Now, of course, if we see now that people were replying that the pandemic will be over in 3 months, it's funny, but at that time was, of course, a possibility. And also regarding the imaginary, a strong positive imaginary towards having children mitigates the negative impact of the pandemic. If we look at more objective measures, the objective status only played a minor role in the adaptation of fertility intentions during the pandemic. These are three models. In model one, we have these covariates, which are the more economic variable, the contingent employment situation. Then in model two, we add perception. And in model three, we add also expectations and imaginaries. And well, as you can see, part of the effects of the objective measures are shaped by perceptions, expectations, and imaginaries. In particular, the effect of job losses and of temporary interruptions of work during the lockdown are not related to the change in fertility intentions. As you can see now, I wanted to give you a more substantive interpretation of our findings. Here we are estimating a multinomial logistic regression and we evaluate and compare the predicted probabilities of decreasing or increasing fertility intentions in light of the pandemic. The findings here show that the more negative expectations about the return to normality, the higher the probability of decreasing fertility intentions during the pandemic. For example, net of all covariates included in the model, for those who did not perceive any change in their personal situation, the probability of decreasing fertility intentions is 10%, while for those who expect that the return to normality will last more than 2 years, have a probability of decreasing their fertility intentions of about 25%. And on the other side, the more negative expectations about return to normality, the lower the probabilities of increasing fertility intentions during the pandemic. So this already provides you some evidence about the role of narratives of the future, about the role of future expectations on the change in fertility intentions due to the lockdown. But we wanted to be even more specific, and we included an experiment in our survey. So what we did at the end of the survey, we presented to the respondents a mock news bulletin concerning the expected end of the pandemic emergency. Actually, this mock news bulletin should have sound very realistic to our respondents, because we did the survey just 1 week after that the President Conte announced on TV that he created a task force of Italian experts working to face the pandemic. And after 1 week, we collected this data and we mentioned this task force, saying that the forecast of the task force, several forecasts of the task force regarding the expected end of the pandemic. So in the experimental approach, respondents were randomly assigned to five expected durations before the return to normality. And then we asked about their fertility intentions in the next 3 years in light of the expected duration of the emergency, and analyze the changes with respect to previously stated intentions. I'm not showing you the manipulation in detail, just to see that the five different scenarios also sound a bit funny now. 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, 2 years, more than 2 years. So what I'm showing now to you is the result of this experiment that allows us to evaluate the causal impact of the new narrative of the future. So we check the change in fertility intention prior and after the exposition to this scenario. So our main independent variable is the treatment, one of the five scenarios. Then we also, to improve the external validity of our findings, we also control to a set of independent variables, to the level of fertility intentions. And sorry, here I forgot to include in the equation, we do also have a recall dummy that is a variable to check the validity of the manipulation, whether individuals got it right. So we also control for that. This is the change in fertility intention after the treatment by the different scenarios. The results suggest that the more negative the narrative of the future, the stronger the reduction of the fertility intentions after the treatment. The randomization, of course, automatically controls for alternative explanations, but we included also a set of covariates in the model, and including these covariates only improves, as expected, the statistical precision of the estimates. And this is the last slide, the last findings I want to show you. They are interesting to get a deeper insight into the interplay between expectations and imaginaries. These are predicted probabilities of increasing or decreasing fertility intentions via combinations of expectations to return to normality and imaginaries. Here, the main message is the strongest increase in fertility intentions occurred among those who have the strongest positive imaginary towards the future and were exposed to the more positive expectations about the return to normality. The strongest decline in fertility intentions is among those with the strongest positive imaginary towards having a child and were exposed to the more negative expectations about the return to normality. So to conclude, regarding the shadow of the path elements of the narrative framework, we find that objective indicators of individual exposure to health and economic consequences played a very limited role in reshaping individuals' fertility plans during the pandemic. Be careful. If we look at the employment and economic condition as determinants of intention, they play a role. Arguing that they play a limited role in the change of fertility intentions because of the pandemic. While regarding the shadow of the future elements of the narrative framework, we find that perceptions of insecurity and especially expectations and imaginaries came out as crucial moderators of individuals' adaptation to a new context characterized by overwhelming uncertainty. In all, what we suggest is that because of COVID-19 induced uncertainty, subjective perceptions and personal narratives of the future, also shaped by media shared narratives, gain the upper hand over the shadow of the past in influencing fertility intentions. And these results are also reinforced by our experimental approach, because we do provide evidence of a causal impact of shared narratives of the future on fertility intentions. So to summarize, here I really want to conclude, the coronavirus disaster offered us an unique opportunity to operationalize our narrative framework in a time of a massive spike in uncertainty, and at the same time, allowed us to provide a robust evidence on the importance of the future, of the narrative of the future in the fertility decision-making process. And I conclude that more research is needed to address the role of personal and shared narratives about economic uncertainty in the study of family dynamics in the era of globalization, technological change, and now also coronavirus. So the Florence team, from this point of view, is always open to collaborations. Thank you.